Yesterday USA. For the good times. For the good times. For the good times.
This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
Howl, howl, howl! Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young and didn't stop you coming through.
And now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio Superstation, the station founded by your friend, my friend, the man with a million friends, Mr. Bill Bragg, down in Richardson, Texas. Hi, Bill. Hope you're doing okay down there. And hello, Steve.
Hi there. Bill is the midnight mayor of Richardson, he said recently.
Yeah, a new title he's given himself. We asked him about that, and he said, only at midnight. So we don't know if that's like from like 12 to 1201 or only at that precise singularity in time-space continuum. Never mind. I don't know what I'm talking about. I think I'm Stephen Hawking here or something. I don't know. Got a good show for you here today, folks. Another couple old-time radio shows to present to you.
Yeah, ones we've never put on before. These are two completely different shows.
You're putting me on.
Mm-hmm. I am? Oh, yes. Well, it's more material than I need, John.
Oh, well, thanks. I need more material because I'm a bigger guy.
That's the name, Big John.
Yes. Anyway.
What was that?
That was just me tweaking my nose.
Tweak. Cute.
No, actually, that's just a little French scooter that keeps driving past here. We have a problem with traffic here, folks, and... Yeah, every now and again, these things just drive through our room. We don't know why.
Well, Traverse City is French, you know. Traverse City.
Yes, and they're traversing our studio here. And, yeah, right, fine. Anyway, that one's going a little slower.
Little old lady from Pasadena was driving that one.
That must be a limousine. Anyway, enough frivolity, folks. Time to get into our first program. It is an episode of That Brewster Boy, starring Eddie Firestone. This is called, we had to self-title this one, actually. It's A Visit from Dottie, airing on NBC Red Network. And we don't have a specific date for this one, but Steve's going to tell you a little bit about it.
Okay, well, we have That Brewster Boy ran from 1941 to 1945. Yes, we said Eddie Firestone is in there. Arnold Stang also had a recurring role, and Dick York. A very young Dick York, at that, was in this series.
Well, Arnold Stang was supporting with... He did a lot of stuff with Henry Morgan, too.
Mm-hmm.
Not the Harry Morgan, but the other Henry Morgan, the comedian.
Right, the Henry Morgan, right.
Okay, I tell you what, let's get on into this one here. And, do you have any more info there? That's it, okay. Reach for the McGee machine, sir. And turn him on there.
I got it.
All right, I see. I heard you flip the switch there. Okay. And there he is warming up. So from NBC Red Network on an unknown date, this is That Brewster Boy, A Visit from Dottie. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember.
Herbert again, so it's up to me to do something. I don't want to drip for a brother-in-law.
Oh, that boy.
That boy.
That Brewster boy. Laker Oats, truly America's super breakfast, brings you That Brewster Boy, written by Pauline Hopkins and starring Eddie Firestone Jr. Did you have your Quaker Oats today? It won't be long now before we all go to work again on the annual list of New Year's resolutions. And I'm going to suggest one item to put on the list of all you wives and mothers. You can word it something like this. In 1942, I resolved to give my family the benefits of a hot breakfast regularly. Yes, and to millions of Americans, hot breakfast means delicious, healthful Quaker Oats. Quaker Oats is America's favorite breakfast, and believe you me, it's a super breakfast, too. You see, fine whole grain oatmeal is the richest, thrifty, natural source of the great anti-fatigue vitamin, the morale vitamin, B1, so widely deficient in American foods. Proteins? Why, whole grain oatmeal leads all other whole grain cereals in proteins. And whole grain oatmeal is a rich source of food energy or body fuel. And remember this. Quaker Oats is super economical. It still costs less than half a cent a serving. So there you have it, ladies. Reason aplenty for giving your family the benefits of a daily hot breakfast of delicious, healthful Quaker Oats in 1942. A good resolution? One of the best. So tomorrow, ask your grocer for the big economical package of delicious, healthful Mother's Oats or Quaker Oats and serve your family America's super breakfast every day. This is the story of an average American family, the Brewsters. Of course, I just don't care what I say when I call all of the Brewsters average. That might be true of Mom and Dad and Nancy. But Joey, well, Joey's as unaverage a young sprout as you're likely to know in some time. Well, now it's dinner time at the Brewsters, and Mother Brewster is saying...
Joey, isn't that your sixth biscuit?
No, Mom.
Now, you're sure?
Positive.
It's my seventh.
Oh, Joey. Daddy isn't eating his vegetables.
Well, Joey, for New Year's, I think you should resolve to eat more vegetables. Pass me the biscuits.
Will you quit dreaming over that bracelet, Nancy?
Now, Phil, don't be silly.
Always looking at it.
What's all this?
The charm bracelet that Herbert gave Nancy for Christmas.
Oh. Well,
didn't I show it to you, Daddy?
Well, no.
Look.
That's very nice, honey.
Nancy's crazy about it.
Phil, I'm crazy about the perfume you gave me, too.
Oh, hey, Dad, I almost forgot. The mailman gave me a letter for you, and I put it in my pocket, and here it is.
Oh, thanks, son. Well, from Max Taylor.
Who, Dad?
The Max Taylor. Went to school with him.
Was he a special friend, Dad?
Yes, he's the sort of friend with whom you sign a pact in blood, Joey. You know, if ever one needs the other.
Yeah, like Chuck and me.
Well, let's see what's on his mind. Excuse me.
You really go for that bracelet, don't you, Nancy?
Oh, Phil, why must you be so jealous?
Well, it isn't a question of jealousy.
Are you sure?
When I see you looking at that with a far-gone expression, I get a kick right in my heart.
Oh, Phil, I think it's icky looking, Phil.
Thanks, pal.
Mother, listen to this. And because we were such good friends, Jim, I'm turning to you for help.
Sounds like a touch.
My daughter, Dottie, has become quite a problem. In and out of love all the time.
Why are girls such lame brains?
Now, Joey.
Just now, Dottie has a weakness for strong men, for the Tarzan type.
The Tarzan type?
In the past year, she's been in love with a piano mover, a prize fighter, and an acrobat.
Good heavens.
You see, Dottie is the very feminine, clinging vine type.
A drip.
Now, Joey.
I know. The kind that's always brushing lint off your lapels.
Just now, Dottie thinks she's in love with a palooka who plays football. Now, this palooka will be in town for the holidays, so I'm very anxious to ship Dottie away for a few days.
Dad, he isn't going to suggest...
Yes, Mother, here it comes. Would it be at all possible for you people to put her up?
Oh, Daddy, no.
If you can, wire me immediately. Regards, Max.
It's impossible, dear.
Oh, but, Mother, I hate to turn Max down.
Now, Dad, we don't want that responsibility.
She sounds like a problem child, Mr. Brewster.
She sounds like a goon child.
Well, I suppose I'll have to wire Max and tell... Oh, wait a minute. Here's a postscript to the letter.
What does it say?
P.S. I just remembered our pact, Jim. So instead of waiting for permission, I put Dottie on the train.
What? Dad.
I'm mailing this airmail so it'll arrive before Dottie. She'll be in your town Monday at 3:35 p.m.
That's tomorrow.
I think it's a terrible imposition, Dad.
Well, yes, but Mother, what can we do? The girl's on her way.
Hey, the door.
I'll get it. I'm expecting someone. Excuse me, please.
She's expecting Herbert.
Never mind, Joey.
Yeah. Ever since he gave her that charm bracelet, his stock's gone up.
Now, Phil, naturally Nancy feels a little obligated.
Naturally. That's why Herbert gave her the bracelet.
Well, Mother, what are we going to do about this Dottie Taylor?
I'm sure I don't know, Dad. A girl who's interested in Tarzans. One who falls in and out of love.
Well, I certainly feel sorry for her family.
Thank goodness we don't have such problems.
Think not, Mrs. Brewster.
Why, Phil?
Well, look at Nancy. Just when I think I have her sewed up, she starts running around with Herbert.
She isn't running around with Herbert, Phil. They've had one date since Christmas.
Two, Mrs. Brewster.
Three.
Joey.
Come on, Herbert. Come in here and tell the family. Oh, will you hear? You'll be pleased too, Phil.
I doubt it.
Well, Herbert.
How are you, Herbert?
Season's greetings, everyone. How are you, sir?
Fine, thank you.
You look wonderful, Mrs. Brewster.
Oh, thank you, Herbert.
Hi, Joey. Well, Phil. Hello, old sock.
Hello, Hill.
When do you hear what Herbert's planning? Oh, it's so exciting.
Doesn't Nancy look cute when she gets excited?
You ought to see me when I get excited.
Oh, now, Phil.
Herbert's going to have a New Year's Eve party.
In Nancy's honor.
Nancy's honor?
Well, sure. Who else?
Well, that sounds very nice.
You kids ought to have a lot of fun.
Am I included, Herbert?
Of course, Joey. You're Nancy's brother.
Am I included, Herbert?
Of course, Phil. You're Nancy... acquaintance.
Oh. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
We're having a house guest, Herbert. Dottie Taylor.
Good. Bring her along. I always say the more women, the better the party.
Oh, say, son, that reminds me. You'll have to meet her at the station.
Dad.
Well, yes, I'll be at work. So you'll see that you meet that train, Joy, tomorrow at 3:35.
I'll bet that's Dottie. Yeah, she looks like a glamour puss. Hey! Hey! Oh, excuse me. But are you Dottie Taylor?
I'm Dorothea Marguerite Taylor. I like the Marguerite part, don't you? It's so romantic. I once read a book about a girl named Marguerite. Maybe you read it. She stowed away on a boat and just
as
she was...
I didn't read it.
Oh, no? Oh, it's terribly romantic. You see, the girl... Oh, by the way, who are you?
I'm Joey Brewster. Dad sent me down to meet your train.
Oh, of course. You know, Joey, it's perfectly ridiculous for me to go home with you.
What?
Because I'm not staying. I'm taking the next train back.
Huh? Now listen.
I know now why my father sent me here. You see, I have a friend who plays football. Oh, Joey, you should see his muscles. And I received a letter from him, and I saved it to read on the train.
Yeah?
And in the letter, he wrote that he was coming to visit me. Now imagine reading that while you're on a train that's taking you miles and miles away from him.
Yeah, but you gotta come home with me, Dottie. The folks are expecting you.
This football player is the strongest man you ever saw, Joey. A real...
Tarzan. Yeah, I know. Come on, Dottie.
Oh. Oh, Joey, wait.
What's the matter?
Look at that man. Just look at him. He's lifting a trunk.
Yeah, with one hand.
And without any effort. Oh, look at his muscles. Oh, what rhythm. What poise. What strength. A Tarzan.
A Tarzan. Hey, Dottie, wait here, will you? I'll be right back.
I'll wait, Joey. I can't move. I'm fascinated. Oh, the ripple of his muscles.
Now, don't go away, Dottie. I have a phone call to make. Yeah, Phil. Yeah, Dottie's really good looking. I think Herbert would go for her.
Yeah, but Joey, Herbert isn't exactly a Tarzan.
Yeah, I know, but couldn't we do something to make Dottie think he is?
Well, it's worth working on.
Hey, but Phil, Dottie doesn't want to stay. She says she's leaving tonight.
Oh, hey, we can't let her do that. Listen, Sprout, you take her home, see? And I'll be over this evening. We'll do our best to persuade her to stay.
Okay, Phil.
Good work, Small Fry. Keep it up.
I thought you'd be interested, Phil. Hey, if Dottie ever falls for Herbert, he'll be out of your hair for good.
Oh, now, Dottie, we won't allow you to cut your visit so short.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Brewster, but really, I must...
But, Dottie, we plan to have you stay with us for several days.
I know, Mrs. Brewster, but I feel that
A friend of mine is giving a New Year's Eve party, Dottie. You're invited, too.
That's very sweet of you, Nancy, only
Herbert's giving the party. You'll like Herbert, won't she, Nancy?
Oh, yes, Herbert's a lot of fun.
I'm sorry, but I think I'd better go home. You see, I'm afraid there's someone back home who'll be terribly disappointed if I'm not there.
The Palooka.
Well, Joey, get the door.
Yeah, okay, Mom.
I inquired about trains. There's one leaving at midnight. Really, I think I'd better be on it.
Well, Dottie, we can't let you leave. What'll your father think of me?
Suppose you stay tonight, and then in the morning we'll talk this over, and if you still...
No, please, Mrs. Brewster. I'd better take the midnight train.
It's Phil. Come on in, Phil.
Oh, good.
Phil, we need your help here.
Oh, really, Mr. Brewster?
Dottie, this is my friend, Philip Hayworth. Philip, this is... Dottie Taylor.
Oh, how do you do, Dottie?
How do you do? You see, if I take the midnight train, then
midnight
I can just...
Midnight train? What's this?
Dottie just arrived, and now she's talking about leaving.
Tell her she's got to stay, Phil.
You see, if I take the midnight train, then I'll get home
just... Oh, hey, hold it. You're not going to be on that train.
Oh, yes, I am. My trunk's in the hall, and I phoned Parmalee to call for
it. Well, I'll carry your trunk upstairs. Where's she staying?
In the guest room, Phil.
Oh, no, please.
Don't
I've got...
Don't argue now. Where's that trunk?
You see... You can't argue with Phil.
You're staying, Dottie.
But really, I...
Take it up to the guest room, Phil.
Okay.
Yeah,
please, wait, I've got...
It's no use, Dottie. Phil's a regular caveman.
And he usually gets his way.
So, you might as well make up your mind to it. You're staying.
Okay. Now, where does this go?
Please, I... Oh, look at him. Look at him lift my trunk.
Out of my way, Joey.
Such strength. Such rhythm, such poise. Look at the ripple of his muscles.
Phil, put down that trunk.
Oh, Tarzan. I'm staying.
Yay!
Joey's plans for helping Phil seem to backfire. Looks to me like Phil is really on the spot now. Well, now, it's a few days later, and instead of getting better, things have been getting worse for Phil. He can't get rid of Dottie. Even at this moment, she's clinging to him and saying...
I'm not going to call you Phil.
No?
I'm going to call you Tarzan.
For the love of heaven, Dottie, where's Nancy?
Oh, now, sit down. You and I are going to have a talk.
Now, get this straight. I came here to see Nancy.
Oh, my. You're a real caveman, aren't you?
Yes. I'm a Pithecanthropus erectus.
A what?
Caveman.
Oh, you have brains, too, haven't you?
Yes, brains and brawn. Where's Nancy?
Oh, please, now, sit down.
Oh, all right.
That's better. Oh, you're tall even when you sit down.
I've got a long neck.
How did you develop such wonderful muscles?
You didn't answer my question. Now, where's Nancy?
Oh, I told Nancy I'd entertain you. There's something so magnificent about your shoulders.
I'm not entertained. Where is she?
Do you know what brute strength does to me? It makes me feel all weak and helpless.
You're not so helpless.
It makes me want to cling.
Now, Dottie, and look.
Cling.
Now, wait a minute, Dottie. Please, Dottie, please.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
Nancy.
Phil and I are having such a cozy little talk, Nancy.
Yes, I noticed.
Oh, now, look, honey bun, I was...
Sorry, Phil, I haven't time. I'm meeting Herbert.
Oh, but Nancy...
I think I heard his car pull up.
Nancy, wait.
I'm sure you'll be in good hands, Phil. Good night.
Good night, Nancy.
Nancy!
Good night, Tarzan. Ooh.
Nancy.
Well, he's gone. Now we can have our talk. What was I saying?
I'm a caveman, and I have wonderful muscles.
Yes.
My shoulders are magnificent. And will you digest this, but thoroughly? I'm taken, see? I'm all tied up. I've been spoken for.
Oh.
And what's more, I haven't any use for silly females. Sorry to be so outspoken, but you're not exactly the subtle type, and you're not exactly my type. Now, you think you understand? Well?
Oh, Tarzan.
Hello, Phil. Come on in.
Wait a minute, small fry. Is Dottie home?
Sure. I'll call her.
You do, and I'll break your neck.
Phil.
I want to talk to Nancy.
Oh, Nancy's out.
Yeah, with Herbert, I suppose.
Sorry, Phil.
Sorry? You're sorry. Whose bright idea was it to persuade Dottie to stay here?
But, Phil, I
can't get rid of that woman.
Don't you worry, Phil. I'm working on a plan.
Well, then I will worry. Now, listen, bottom button. Keep out of this, see? I've got my own plan. I'll handle this in my own way. I'll take care of that leech. Well, tell Nancy I was here. Good night.
Good night, Tarzan.
What?
I said good night. Jeepers, he sure burned. Oh, well, he'll forgive me when I work out my plan. Da-dum, da-dee-dee-dee-dee, da. Dottie.
Yes, Joey?
Don't go away. I haven't finished talking to you.
Oh, no, Joey, I'm still here.
Now, Dottie, like I was saying, you're just kidding yourself, see?
I am?
No, Wolfen. You're not cooking with charcoal.
No?
No, you don't like Tarzan. You don't like brute strength. You have too much heart for that.
Too much heart. Go on, Joey.
You like the underdog. The guy that gets licked. He appeals to the maternal in you.
The maternal in me?
Sure, that's right. It's the fellow who's down. The fellow who's out. That's your type. The one who gets picked on. That's the one you really go for.
You know, Joey, I think you're right. I'm getting awfully tired of cavemen.
Of course you are.
The fellow that's down. The fellow that's licked. Where can I find such a man?
I'll take care of that. Herbert.
Hmm?
Yeah, Herbert. You love him. He never wins anything. The perfect flop.
You're feeling fine, are you, Herbert?
Why the sudden interest in my health?
Well, after all, Herbert, that's my chosen profession. You know, health, medicine.
Okay. Let's deal off the top. Now, Phil, you know you'd slip arsenic in my coffee if you thought you could get away with it.
Oh, now, Herbert.
Wouldn't you?
Not arsenic. Maybe a Mickey Finn, but not arsenic.
Well, what do you want? Why are you here?
Why,
If it's about Nancy, I'm making pretty good ground there now, and I'm not giving up no matter what you do.
Well, I didn't come here to talk about Nancy. I came to discuss your New Year's Eve party.
Yeah? Well, start discussing.
Having any entertainment?
An orchestra, naturally. Maybe I'm not so good at making pretty speeches, but on the dance floor, my feet talk for me.
Oh, but Herbert, you've got to have entertainment.
What sort of entertainment?
Well, I've worked out a plan. Suppose you and I put on a jiu-jitsu contest.
Jiu-jitsu? But I'm good at that.
I know you're good.
I'm taking lessons.
I know you're taking lessons.
I can't lose at jiu-jitsu.
I know you can't lose.
A twist of the wrist and I'd bounce you on your ear.
Herbert, I'd love to be bounced on my ear.
But then I'd be the hero. I'd win. You'd be licked. You'd be a flop.
That's just what I'm counting on, Herbert. I'm counting on being a complete flop.
Good music, huh, Nancy?
Very nice.
Oh, Nancy.
Hmm?
Come back. You're far away.
Am I?
What are you thinking of?
I was thinking that soon it'll be a new year, and we're starting it off all wrong.
Oh, you mean that perhaps...
What's that? What's going to happen?
Oh, it's time for our act.
Act?
Oh, the contest. Excuse me, Nancy. I have to make a speech. Ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, the big event of the evening.
Hey, Phil, what's this going to be, do you know?
Stick around, small fry.
A jiu-jitsu contest between me and Philip Haywood.
Phil, he's good at that.
Yeah, here's where I flop, small fry.
Oh, but Phil.
Are you ready, Philip?
I'm ready, Herbert.
Oh, wait, Phil, don't do
it. A test of brute strength, ladies and gentlemen.
Phil, you don't know what you're doing.
I know.
Ah, my opponent. We shake hands, get into position.
Yeah.
Now, I hold him there, and there, a twist of the wrist, and...
Oh, he's here. Phil! Oh. Phil!
Phil, are you hurt?
Huh?
Oh, my poor, poor boy. Oh,
yikes. Oh, wait a minute, Dottie. Herbert's the hero. Congratulate him.
Oh, my poor boy. Rest your head on my shoulder.
But, Dottie, he's...
Perfectly... What a beautiful exhibition. Congratulations, Phil.
Oh, Nancy, wait.
I'm going home. I've had enough of this old party.
Nancy, Dottie, will you get off my neck?
Oh, my poor boy. Joey was right.
What?
Joey said the maternal in me was strong. Joey said I'd like the underdog, the man who flopped.
Joey. Joey, come here.
Now, listen, Phil.
Get away, Dottie. Let me up my feet. Joey, did
now,
you...
Now, wait a minute, Phil.
I'd like to...
Don't touch me.
I'd like to
Phil,
take you and
don't
knock...
Don't touch him, you brute.
Huh? What?
Don't you dare pick on him. Oh, Joey, you look so helpless.
Dottie?
Don't you worry. I won't let him pick on you.
You... Phil, wait.
Work it out for yourself, small fry. No love.
Oh, Phil, don't leave me.
Oh, Joey, you... Poor boy, you look so helpless.
Yeah.
Help! Help!
Well, Mother, it'll soon be time for the New Year's bells.
Yes, Dad.
Honey. Nancy.
Yes, Dad.
Why didn't you stay at the party and see the new year in?
I didn't want to. Am I in the way here?
Of course not, dear.
Why, no. Mother and I don't mind holding hands in front of you.
Nancy?
It's Phil.
Oh, I hope you don't mind my barging in. The door was unlocked.
Well, not at all. Come in, Phil.
I'm glad you came, Phil.
Oh, Nancy. Did you think you were going to start out a new year without me?
Oh, Phil. What was that?
Sounded like the door.
Dad! Dad!
Oh, it's Joey.
Come in here, son. Time to make your New Year's resolution.
Dad, listen. I resolved to carry out the ashes every day and wipe and wash the dishes.
What?
Only please, please send Dottie home.
Why, Joey.
Son.
Please, Dan. Ooh, the bells.
New Year's.
Happy New Year, honey.
Boy. Happy New Year, Phil. Happy New Year, Dad.
Happy New Year, Mother. Joey, I'll send Dottie home tomorrow.
You will? Oh, Happy New Year, Joey.
Tonight, the makers of Quaker Oats pay tribute to America's armed forces. The Army, the Navy, the Marines, and all the other branches of service. In special tribute, we salute the Quartermaster Corps, the men who furnish the food and clothing and other supplies to the troops. You've heard the Marine hymn, the Navy's great song, the marching song of the field artillery. And tonight we bring you for the first time on a coast-to-coast network, the official song of the Quartermaster Corps, a great marching song written by two officers of the Quartermaster Corps, Major D.G. Paston and Lieutenant H. Orenstein and Edward Fox. Here it is, the official song of one of the most important branches of the United States Army. Glenn Welty and the orchestra bring us a stirring rendition of We're the Gang That Keeps Things Moving.
When there is trouble brewing at the front and trucks are rumbling up the road, the men who bear the stormy battle's front know it's there to share the load. They know we'll go through fiery shot and shell to bring supplies for men and guns as well. You can be sure the QM's coming out, or you can hear the soldiers shout. We're the gang that keeps this guy who's fighting by his side will be from the quarter of the
that has serious but funny consequences. And we'll probably hear him talking to Chuck on the phone, saying...
Hello, Chuck. Hey, look, if I'm going to be appointed traffic court judge on safety day, I got to have a campaign slogan. Yeah, something sharp. Yeah, something that'll make them realize I'm a pretty rugged gent. Yeah, something that'll make them see how smart I am, how honest, how trustworthy, how dependable. You what? You got a slogan for me, Chuck? Yeah? What is it? Oh, Joey for judge.
Be sure to tune in again next Monday night at the same time for another enjoyable evening with That Brewster Boy. Meanwhile, be sure to ask your grocer for Quaker Oats, truly America's super breakfast. The original music on this program was created and conducted by Glenn Welty. This is Marvin Miller speaking for the makers of Quaker Oats. All of us on That Brewster Boy join the Quaker Oats Company in wishing you and yours a very happy and prosperous new year. This is the Red Network of the National Broadcasting Company.
Top of the morning to you. This is Arthur Anderson. But let's pretend I'm Lucky the Leprechaun. You're listening to the Glowing Dial here in Yesterday, USA. Oh, you like the Glowing Dial. For us, said Arthur Anderson, it's magically nostalgic. That doesn't quite scan, does it? But you know what I mean.
Yes, we know what you mean. Thank you very much, Arthur. Hope you folks enjoyed Eddie Firestone in That Brewster Boy. And that seems to have been toward the end of the year there. They wished us Happy New Year at the end of it anyway.
That would be 1941 then, because it only ran, you know, not even one full year.
Okay, well, so very late December 1941. We can actually probably try to figure out exactly, if we had a perpetual calendar, when that would have been. But anyway, it's time to move on into our next program. Mr. Urbanek, that's going to be is going to have some information for us. It's an episode of the incomparable Charlie Chan.
Ah, yes, Charlie Chan. Incomparable.
And number one son. Number one son, gold number one. Ha, 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 ha. This is a an isolated episode from, because these were all serialized. We just have this this one here. It's the case of the marching ants. And it aired on the ABC network, and here's Mr. Urbanek with a little more info.
Okay, well, Charlie Chan had many installments over the years. He ran from a film starting in 1931. His radio career started in 1932, and he went into all the way till 1948 in various installments here. This one is a 15-minute episode from mid to late 1945 on the ABC network. Cast members were Ed Begley and Leon Janney, so...
Ooh.
That should be what we're looking for here.
Yeah, well, okay, I tell you what, if you will reach for our friend the McGee machine here, and we'll get this thing going. Okay.
Click-a-rooney.
There we go. Yeah. He's warming himself up right now. Okay, so from the ABC network, this is the incomparable Charlie Chan in the case of the marching ants.
Charlie Chan.
Yes, and we'll add this before we start. Thank you very much. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember.
The incomparable Charlie Chan. The American Broadcasting Company presents the incomparable Charlie Chan, detective, philosopher, modern Chinese sage in a new and exciting series. Join the famous detective every day at this time, Monday through Friday, as he combines the wisdom of the East and the science of the West in a thrilling and dramatic chapter from The Adventures of Charlie Chan.
Charlie Chan humbly gives you a greeting and extends warm welcome. Sage has said, nature sometimes reveals deepest truths in wildest jokes. Today, apparent joke revealed truth about murder. But first word from honorable announcer.
Until the war with Japan is completely won, our fighting forces will need the full support of every American on the home front. Today, they are combining in an all-out attack against Japan. In planes, ships, and tanks, our fighters are battling forward to total victory. And we must help them gain that victory. Here's what we're asked to do. Stay on war jobs until finally released. Keep on buying more and more war bonds. Keep on supporting home front activities and observing wartime regulations. These next months will be vitally important. In your letters to servicemen, tell them you know what they're up against. Let them know that a united America is behind them as they face the fight that lies ahead. In spite of recent setbacks, our Japanese enemy remains strong and determined to fight to the last ditch. The harder we fight here at home, the sooner will come the day of peace. So don't let up for a minute, because minutes lost may mean lives lost. And now, back to Charlie Chan. This week's adventure, The Case of the Marching Ant. Howard Rourke, eccentric student of necromancy and alchemy, has called Charlie Chan to his home to explain a strange procession of marching ants, which Rourke believes presages his own death, punishment by the spirit world for unearthing its secrets. Chan and his son follow the marching ants to a large vine-covered oak tree behind the crypt where Rourke conducts his mysterious researches. In the tree, Chan's son discovers a dead body. Now Chan and his son confer with Lieutenant Locke as the homicide squad removes the grim corpse from its strange coffin.
It's quiet over here, Chan. Let's kick this case around a while. I want to get a few things straight. Now, what kind of a guy is this Rourke?
Mr. Howard Rourke, lawyer and banker by profession. Formerly senior member of law firm Rourke and Hastings.
Uh-huh.
Also vice president, Pacific Coast Bank and Trust Association. Now retired.
Oh, yeah? Well, what's he do now?
Gentleman considerably advanced in years. Apparently well-to-do. In natural position to be eccentric.
Eccentric?
Yeah, he believes in ghosts.
Oh, now listen, Junior.
So sorry, Lieutenant. Miserable son not guilty of bad joke. Mr. Rourke, apparently believer in spirit world.
Oh, yeah?
Is student of occult matters. Were called into case because Mr. Rourke believed procession of ants and gathering of birds near House of Death foretold threat of death by spirits.
What is this House of Death routine?
Rourke's got a kind of a miniature tomb rigged up as an alchemist laboratory. It's got a coffin in it and a lot of weird stuff.
Oh, now look, you don't believe that malarkey about spirits having the birds and ants warn, Rourke.
No. Obvious that both insects and birds attracted to tree by dead body residing inside. Only man of morbid eccentricity like Rourke would fail to draw obvious conclusion.
Look, they've got the body laid out on the grass now, Chan. Let's go over and have a look, huh?
Yes, we'll do.
Hey, Pop, here comes Rourke. He looks wilder than ever.
Inspector Chan.
Yes, Mr. Rourke.
Inspector Chan, this body in the tree, I assure you, sir, I had no idea. I mean that...
You mean what?
Well, I'm not a fool. I understand the finger of suspicion pointed at me. You must understand, Inspector, I did not kill that man. Surely you must see that I would never have called you in on the case if I had... If I had...
We also see that maybe that's exactly the way you want us to think.
Oh, no. No, surely you can't believe that.
Surely this and surely that. You'll find out what we believe when we've made up our minds, Rourke. Now, Peter, go back to your house. We've got a date with this corpse. Now, go on, get out of here.
Very well, Lieutenant.
I don't like that guy, Chan. You're right, he's a nut. And it comes to my mind that sometimes nuts like to run around bumping people off just for fun. Well?
I'm not commenting on theory, Lieutenant Locke, but on appearance of body. Has been dead over 2 days. Probably killed Saturday or Friday and placed in tree.
Yeah.
Body covering considerably discolored by residents in tree. Yet close examination reveals what facts?
Well, he's wearing pajamas.
Holy smoke, they got him out of bed to kill him.
Very interesting, huh? Now, observe. Killed with single shot through temple. Examine wound, please. Dead man probably killed with 22 caliber gun.
22? That's practically a toy.
In this case, Lieutenant Locke, lethal toy.
Why would a murderer take a chance with a 22 when he could use a large gun?
Must save interesting speculation for future, son. Papers from wallet in pocket reveal identity of dead man.
Oh, who is he, Chan?
Name Samuel Brighton. Address 99 Walker Road, this city. Business address Pacific Coast Trust Building.
Hey, that was Rourke's firm.
Yes.
Ah, it's beginning to smell awful fishy.
Then apply further bit of evidence to nostrils. Mr. Samuel Brighton, lawyer by profession.
Then Rourke was a lawyer, too.
Say the word, Chan. I put the finger on Rourke.
Oh, wait. One other curious clue demands further investigation.
What's that?
How does dead man happen to carry wallet in pajama pocket? Obviously planted there. We're obviously intended to find body and identify same. Charlie Chen, very unhappy with case.
Well, okay, what's next on the program, Chen?
Too late for further work tonight. Wish now to return home for a much-needed rest. We'll continue in morning.
Oh. Well, how about the reporters? Can they break the story? They can just about make the bulldog additions.
I may break story, Lieutenant Locke, but no pictures, please.
Right.
Son and self wish you good night. I'm very much afraid night will be unsatisfactory for self. We'll probably dream about murder.
Hey, Pop.
Yes, son?
I thought you said we were going home to go to bed. It's 5 o'clock, Pop. It's light outside.
So?
Been sitting in the study for an hour.
So sorry. I was endeavoring to untangle strange threads of difficult case.
Come on upstairs, Pop. You gotta get some sleep. That's a phone. Who could be calling this late?
Very strange. Yes, please?
Inspector Chan?
Speaking.
I've just seen the headlines about Sam Brighton's murder.
Yes?
I know who killed Brighton. It was Everard Brighton, the guy who runs the Brighton Club down on Pacific Boulevard.
You claim Samuel Brighton killed by Everard Brighton? Gentleman related?
No.
You have evidence to substantiate claim?
Plenty.
Who calling, please?
My name's Clarence Brighton. I'll give you all the evidence you want tomorrow. Good night, Inspector.
Very strange.
Yeah, I heard all that, Pop. Just a crazy practical joke. Yeah, forget it. Come to bed, huh?
Everard Brighton accused of murder of Samuel Brighton by a gentleman named Clarence Brighton. Most perplexing.
What? Again?
Yes, please.
Inspector Chan?
Speaking.
I've just seen the news in the headlines, Inspector. I know who killed Samuel Brighton. It was Clarence Brighton, chap who runs the shooting concession at the Seaside Carnival.
And your name, please?
I'm Everard Brighton. Come and see me tomorrow, Inspector. I'll blow your blasted case sky high for you. Good night.
This person's brain now spinning like carousel.
A couple of wise guys, Pop, trying to take you for a ride. Probably those reporters getting even because you wouldn't let them take pictures.
Get car from garage, son.
Huh? Pop, you mean, you think those guys were real?
Yes. Necessary to question them first thing tomorrow morning. Means examination of Mr. Samuel Brighton's papers and history necessary tonight. We drive to business office of same at once. Truly, it is written, only fool goes hunting with unloaded gun.
How much farther, Pop?
This is last flight. Mr. Samuel Brighton's office on third floor.
What time is it?
6 o'clock.
Lucky for us, the building janitor came on duty. I'd hate to try and pick the locks on the door of this building.
Yes, but we'll have to do the same with door of Brighton's office. Here is corridor.
I can't figure the score on this case, Pop. Now there's 3 Brightons involved. 1 corpse and 2 suspects. How do they tie together?
Son merely voices questions that perplex father. Wait. Here's door. We'll try skeleton keys unlock.
Pop.
Yeah, son?
The doorknob. It's turning. Pop, I can see a shadow on the glass. A man with a gun.
Quick, son, run. Must get around the corner of corridor.
The killer?
Yes, cannot fight armed man.
He's after us, Pop. I hear him coming out of the door.
Get around the corner. Jump.
We will return to Charlie Chan in just a moment. Experienced seamen know better than anyone else that there is no substitute for experience at sea. And they know that in wartime, the merchant marine needs thousands of extra men to man the new Liberty ships. This is an emergency. The merchant marine is desperately in need of experienced men, especially licensed engineers and deck officers. If our merchant marine is to continue the fine job it has been doing, there must be thousands more experienced men to sail the ships. Apprentice seamen are doing their best, but they can't do the job alone. They must have your sea experience to lead the way. Now, if you're a licensed officer or have your certificate as an AB or fireman, oiler, or water tender, sign on today. This is a job which you and you alone can fill. You and you alone know how to do it. Wire collect to Merchant Marine, Washington, D.C. Give your rating and address. Go back to sea and help get those supplies to our fighting men. And now, here is Charlie Chan.
Strange case of marching ants. Complicated by entrance of 2 gentlemen also named Brighton and rendered hazardous by appearance of killer in office of dead man. Hope further complications of incendiary nature do not impede investigation of case. Hope you will join self on same tomorrow. Until then, goodbye. Thank you.
Be sure to join us again tomorrow at the same time for the case of the marching ants. There'll be more thrills, excitement, and comedy in The Adventures of Charlie Chan. The Adventures of Charlie Chan are based on the famous character created by Earl Durr Biggers.
Hi, this is Bob Hastings. Just telling you that you should be listening to Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve on Yesterday USA. Don't miss it. It's fun.
Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy, how much fun can it possibly be? Hi, folks, we're back. Oh, my God, what's going to happen to Charlie Chan in that next episode? I don't know, because we don't have the next episode. That was a singular episode. What we're going to do in Newark, folks, is hopefully come back with some serials and some more 15-minute programs. so we can give you a little bit more variety. We've got some couple next doors here and some strange Dr. Weird, but aside from that, there's not a whole lot 15-minute stuff to that we currently have, so we're going to stock up on that.
Why don't we go to the convention in Battle Creek and get some cereals?
They're great!
Thank you very much, Steve. Pop your nose on that one there. Speaking of the Friends of Old Time Radio Convention, that is going to be October 21st, 22nd, 23rd, and I think that's it, 3 days, right? What, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, in Newark, New Jersey. And we hope that all of you listening can make it out to that. If you need more information on it, it is on my website, www.glowingdial.com. And on the main page there, there is a link to a page that has all the convention information, and it's not too late. It's almost upon us, but you might still be able to get a reservation there for the convention. You may not get into the host hotel, but there are nearby hotels, too. So, Steve, you had a note to bring us here.
Yes, that Brewster boy, I've been doing some reading here on the perpetual calendar and found the exact date of that installment we had earlier today. It was December 29th of 1941.
Oh, very, very good. All right.
We like to have accuracy on the show.
Right. What did we just, Steve ran down and checked the almanac and the perpetual calendar, and here we go. December 29th, 1941 is your date for the Brewster Boy.
Speaking of dates, John, I would at this time like to thank you for the 10 years that I've known you now. This time of the year is the anniversary for us when I first met you back in the singles group 10 years ago.
Aw, I'm getting so misty. Excuse me, I have to blow my nose. That's better.
Can I give you a tissue? How about some live tissue?
I've got enough of that as it is. I have to lose some of it, you see.
I got some of it from Strange Dr. Weird.
Anyway, folks, we want to let you know how to get in contact with us here before we're running out of time right now here. Three methods to do that. First of all, there's email, which is that's my website. It's Glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at Voyager.net. That's the email. The snail mail address is The Glowing Dial, 1055 Townhouse Lane, Traverse City, Michigan, 49686. And the phone number is 810-774-0112. That's right. So use any or all of those means to contact us. Let us know what you think of the show. And if you have any requests, let us know. If you don't have it, we'll find it for you.
We've done that before.
Yes, we have. So hope to see you at the convention. Until next time, actually, this is Big John and Steve saying keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and we see you on the radio. Bye-bye.
Here's how to make breakfast as exciting as a circus and a three-day rodeo rolled into one.
Shredded, roasted for your breakfast. Start the day all shining bright. Gives you lots of cowboy energy with a flavor that's just right. It's delicious and nutritious, bite-sized and ready to eat. Take a tip from home, go and tell your mom. Shredded, roasted, and me.
For better breakfast, it's Ralston. One, two, three. Shredded Ralston, the ready-to-eat bite-sized cereal. Regular Ralston and Instant Ralston, the delicious hot cereals. Look for these whole-grain cereals in the red and white checkerboard packages. For better breakfasts,